Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the case of the week. History: 46-year-old male came with complaints of seizures, tonic contractions of both upper limb, more on the right, followed by right lower limb, headache after the seizure activity, deviation of mouth towards right side, uprolic eyeballs associated with tongue bite, no history of loss of consciousness, no postictal confusion, no history of trauma, fever, loose motions, vomitings, or animal bite. He was a known case of type 2 diabetes mellitus since 18 years on human insulin, even on oral hypoglycemic drugs, that is metformin and glimepiride. Not a known case of hypertension, CVA, TB or thyroid disease. Not a known smoker, occasional alcoholic. So he was referred to MRI. So these are the T2 axial weighted images. You can see edema in the left parietal lobes, also edema in the left superior frontoparietal lobes. Here you can see these are the zoomed images. You can see hyperintense cortex surrounded by hypointense T's in the subcortical white matter. Coming to the FLAIR images, you can see edema in the left superior frontoparietal lobes, hyperintense cortex, and surrounded by hypointense T's in the subcortical white matter. These are the hypointense T's in the subcortical white matter. Comparing both T2 and FLAIR, you can see the hyperintense cortex surrounded by hypointense subcortical white matter. Coming to diffusion weighted images, you see restricted diffusion on DWA. Even on GRE, you can see hyperintense cortex and the hypointense is in the subcortical white matter. Coming to post contrast images, you can see irregular nodular and leptomeningeal enhancement. Coronal and sagittal weighted images, you can see irregular nodular and leptomeningeal enhancement in the above mentioned areas. So coming to the differentials, postictal edema or sequelae, acute or subacute infarcts, encephalitis, non-ketotic hyperglycemic seizures, diabetic or hypoglycemic or metabolic encephalopathy, hypoxic ischemic injury or vascular insult, neoplastic etiology or paraneoplastic syndrome should be considered. Coming to the investigations, urine glucose was 3+, ketone bodies were negative, random blood sugar is 407, glycosylated hemoglobin is 10, suggestive of poor glycemic control. Sodium is 137, which is at the lower limit of the normal. Potassium is normal, chlorides are normal. Urine sugar is 3+, ketone bodies were negative. Fasting blood sugar is 393, postprandial is 414. Even the cholesterol, triglycerides, LDLs and VLDLs were raised. So coming to the negative history, no history of fever, so encephalitis is less likely. No history of significant loss of weight or appetite, no history of primary elsewhere, so neoplastic etiology is less likely. No signs or laboratory investigations such as hypoglycemia, so hypoglycemia or metabolic encephalopathy is less likely. No history of weakness of limbs before the seizure activity, so CVA or stroke is less likely. No history of abnormal or involuntary movements, so suggestive of chorea, because there is other condition like non-ketotic hyperglycemic hemichorea. So on the various etiologies present with subcortical T2 hyperintensity, cortical hyperintensity and post-contrast leptomeningeal or cortical enhancement, seizures in the clinical setting of uncontrolled hyperglycemia, hyperosmolar states and absence of ketone bodies suggest the possibility of non-ketotic hyperglycemia induced seizures. So what is this non-ketotic hyperglycemia induced seizures? So it is one of the severe neurological complications along with non-ketotic hyperosmolar coma and non-ketotic hyperglycemic hemichorea syndrome. These hyperglycemic seizures are seen in both diabetes type 1 and type 2. Seizures are more common in greater than 50 years of age. Slight female predilection. It is a condition, it can be associated with high blood glucose levels, normal or increased serum osmolarity as hyperosmolar states as we have seen in this case, and negative urine ketone bodies to differentiate it from diabetic ketoacidosis. Because seizures in ketotic coma are rare, since ketoacidosis is considered to protect the brain from convulsions. So what is the pathophysiology? Decreased GABA levels is seen in non-ketotic state. Hyperglycemia leading to attenuation of potassium ATP channels, which causes depolarization, which leads to neuronal excitability and seizures. So hyperglycemia will lead to excitatory toxic cell damage, which results in development of excessive free radicals, that is iron, which are deposited in the subcortical white matter, leading to subcortical white matter injury. So hyperglycemia leading to excitotoxic cell damage, resulting in development of excessive free radicals or iron, which are deposited in the subcortical white matter, causing subcortical white matter injury, which is seen as hypointensities on T2 flare GRE in subcortical white matter, which is pathognomonic for this non-ketotic hyperglycemia induced seizures. Other cause of subcortical T2 hypointensity, infected etiologies like meningitis or viral encephalitis, hemorrhagic infarct or hypoxic ischemic insults, neoplastic etiology. So what is the cause of restricted diffusion? Focal hypoxic or ischemic injury leading to excitotoxic damage, mitochondrial dysfunction, which in turn leads to failure of sodium potassium ATPase pump, cellular swelling, which leads to cytotoxic edema. So restricted diffusion of DWI is due to cytotoxic edema. What is the cause for this hyperintense cortex on T2 and flare? So cytotoxic edema along with hyperperfusion and vasogenic edema. So hyperperfusion and vasogenic edema will lead to this hyperintensities in the cortex. And restricted diffusion of DWI is due to cytotoxic edema. So what is the cause for leptomeningeal enhancement? Because of increased perfusion, vascular permeability, which results in loss of blood-brain barrier. So increased perfusion and vascular permeability resulting in damage to the blood-brain barrier, which causes the leptomeningeal enhancement. So we will see this other condition, that is history of chronic uncontrolled diabetes with involuntary movements or chorea in the left upper and lower limb. You can see T1 hyperintense areas in the right basal ganglia, which are hypointense on T2 and flare in a case of chronic uncontrolled diabetes with involuntary movements or chorea in the left upper and lower limb, that is the contralateral limb, will definitely suggest diagnosis of diabetic steatopathy or non-ketotic hyperglycemic hemichorea. So we'll see hyperintensities in the basal ganglia, which are hypointense on T2 and flare in case of chronic uncontrolled diabetes with involuntary movements or chorea or hemibalismus in the opposite limb is classic for this case, that is diabetic steatopathy or non-ketotic hyperglycemic hemichorea syndrome. Other CNS complications are severe stroke, cerebrovascular disease, white matter changes, hypoglycemia, cognitive defects or neuropathies, diabetic encephalopathy, vasculitis or bleeds. So whenever a patient comes with chronic uncontrolled hyperglycemia with hyperosmolar states, with negative ketone bodies and seizures, definitely consider this condition of non-ketotic hyperglycemia induced seizures, because controlling the glucose levels, maintaining adequate hydration which decreases the hyperosmolar states, and using anti-epileptic treatments for the seizures is very important in treating this condition, that is non-ketotic hyperglycemia induced seizures. These are the few references which I have taken. Thank you all.